To understand the message of the Bhagavad Gita, it is essential to know a little background of the day of the war, where millions of soldiers, commanders, etc. were arrayed and the war bugles were sounded from both sides. Until the day of the war, Arjuna's mind was full of raging feelings of a revenge on the Kauravas for all the humiliation they have heaped on him and his family, including the public disrobing of Draupadi. He knew that the whole burden of winning the war for his brothers was on his shoulders. All the 13 years of exile, he single-mindedly pursued the skill upgradation of his war technologies. However, he had his own doubts about two specific persons in the enemy camp, Bhishma and Drona. Knowingly that hidden fears on Arjuna's mind, Lord Krishna brought the chariot and placed it right in front of those very two legendary warriors. What happened as Arjuna glanced at those two legends was vividly captured in the Bhagavad Gita in chapter 1 and 2 with the slokas 28 onwards. Drishtve mam swajanam krishna yujutsam samupasthitam sidhandi mama gatrani mukham cha parisushyati vepathuscha sharire me roma harshascha jayate gandivam sram sate hasta tvacheva paridahiyate eva muktva arjuna sankhe rathopastha upavishat visrajya shasharam chapam shokasam vignamanasa eva muktva rishikesham gudakesha parantapa nayotsya iti govinda muktva tushnim babuvah. Having said thus, Arjuna told to Krishna, I will not fight, and became silent. A close look at all that Arjuna told to Krishna revealed the following. 1. From the shivering of his hands, parching of mouth, sweating of body, talking unconnected, illogical things, it was obvious Arjuna was showing off most of the symptoms that a 21st century psychiatrist will diagnose as symptoms of anxiety neurosis and an attack of mild depression. It was no wonder the great psychiatrist called Vedavyas rightly named the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita as Arjuna Vishada Yoga, where the word Vishada means depression. 2. Arjuna felt that getting back the kingdom would be only at the cost of mass killing, which include his own relatives, revered elders, etc. on either side. 3. He also felt that those deaths would disrupt ageless social order and customs and the sufferings of the soul in the lower world in the absence of none left to perform their death rituals, etc., which would surely accrue in grave sin. 4. His sick mind preferred on death resorting to begging for a livelihood, etc., to the accruing of grave sin. In short, the thoughts like death, killing, or being killed by others, accrual of sin, negative feelings, pessimism, etc., weighed heavily on Arjuna's mind, forcing him not to fight. Yet, he partially disclosed the reason behind his strange and sudden behavior to Lord Krishna when he said that
karpanya doshopahata swabhava prachyami tam dharma samudachetaha yat shreyasya nischitam bruhitan me shishyasteham shadimam tvam prapannam nahi prapashyamya mama panudhyat yachoka muchoshanam indriyanam avapya bhuma vasa पत्समृद्धं राज्यं सुराणामपि चाधिपत्यम् एवमुक्त्वा ऋषिकेशं गुडाखेशपरन्तप नयोच्य इति गोविन्द मुक्त्वा तूष्णीं बभूवः
Saying thus, Arjuna, with a mind disturbed out of depression, set aside his bow and arrows and sank on the floor of the chariot. Arjuna was aware that the burden of winning the war solely was on his shoulders. He was quite confident of defeating all but two from the enemy camp, Grandfather Bhishma, because he was of a Ichamrityu, the death only at his sweet will, and his own Guru Dronacharya, who could not be killed or defeated until he laid down his weapon. So long as they were alive, winning the battle with the Kauravas was impossible for Arjuna. Fear of failure weighed down his mind the moment Arjuna saw Grandfather Bhishma and Guru Drona at a close distance. He suddenly realized that he would not be able to live up to the high expectations of his brothers. The outcome was sudden attack of acute anxiety neurosis and mild depression. In any mental related issues, unless the patient accepts that he has a problem and willingly undergoes a medication or counseling by a doctor or a specialist, the cure is very difficult. Here, by acknowledging his perceived problems, Arjuna showed his willingness to listen to Lord Krishna's advice for his welfare. In addition, Lord Krishna was quick to diagnose the real issue and start the right treatment of counseling with a smiling face when he said that
tamuvacha rishikesha prahasanniva bharata senayorubayor madhye vishidandamidam vacha.
After the end of the session that might have lasted not more than half an hour, Arjuna stood up and declared that
nashto moha smritir labdhva तत्प्रसादात्मयाच्युतः स्थितोऽस्मि गतसंदेह करिष्ये वचनं तव.
Krishna, by your grace my delusion has been destroyed and I have gained wisdom. I am free of all doubts. I shall do your bidding. The world is never short of Arjunas. Their number is all the time on the rise, making Srimad Bhagavad Gita ever relevant. If we take a look around us, it is not difficult to spot thousands of Arjunas. In each home, the husband and wife have high expectations from each other. Both in turn have high expectations from their children. The children have similar expectations from their parents. In schools, the students and teachers have high expectations from each other. The school management has high expectations from the teachers and the parents. The parents have high expectations from the school management. The lovers have high expectations from each other. In the workplace, the employees and the employers have high expectations from each other. In industries or business establishment, the employees and the employers have high expectations from each other. In the ashram, the devotees have high expectations from the swamis. So have the swamis from the devotees. In the temples, the devotees have high expectations from God and the temple management. The temple management also have high expectations from the devotees. The followers of the most of the religions, the case is the same. The voters have high expectations from their elected representatives. India has high expectations from Pakistan, and that rogue nation Pakistan also has high expectations from India. Director and his dedicated scientist of ISRO and the nation had high expectations from the mission Chandrayaan. But when It failed to land on the moon as planned. The mood of the nation was gloomy. And the director, Dr. K. Shivan, broke down and cried inconsolably on the shoulders of the Prime Minister of India on 6th September 2019, in full view of the whole world, was a classic case of falling apart of high expectations. The world around is so fragile that the moment one realizes that his expectations are not going to be realized and correct his stance suitably, the outcome is quick and fast, nervous breakdowns, to breakup of interpersonal relationship, and finally the disruption of a social order. It is no wonder that human relationships are highly strained, full of suspicion everywhere. The outcome is widespread broken families, violence, divorces, single parents, health issues, cigarette smoking, consumption of liquor, narcotic, business closures, lockouts, murders, rapes, wars, etc. The only person who does not have any expectations from anyone, including his self-certified devotees, is Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of God. He, being the Supreme Lord of the universe, has nothing left to be achieved or acquired. It was not for nothing Lord Krishna has a smile on his face at all time. Lord Krishna makes it clear at many places in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita when he says that
Name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinjana nana vaptam vaptavyam varta eva cha karmani.
That message of not harboring any expectation from anyone is one of the core messages of Bhagavad Gita. It is the tool to root out every conceivable human-related issues of the world. But does it mean that one has to keep quiet? No. Lord Krishna clarifies it further when he says,
Yadi yaham navarteyam jatu karmanya tandrita mama vartmanu vartande manushya partha sarvasha.
If I do not work, the whole world will follow me and the outcome would be another disaster. The secret lies in working without expectations. Again, the same technique that is the core advice of Bhagavad Gita. Thus the parents, without expectation, can tell their kids to excel, maybe in studies or in any other field, as per their inner aptitude, physical capacities, etc. They can also give time for them to bring out their best with regular review and feedbacks on the mutually set targets. They can withhold or postpone the yearly vacations, birthday gifts, etc. in case of failure to meet the set targets. But expecting children to become a Virat Kohli or a child prodigy in the selected field within the next couple of years so that the parents' name would be splashed across the TVs or newspapers will surely create another Arjuna's issue in the parents. In the schools, workplaces, industries, etc., the management can continue to give feedback to his employees with areas to improve and the likely actions like cutting off increments, promotions in case of their failure to shore up their performance. The management can promptly act on their plan. The moment they see no improvement in the work from the employees, again, without any expectations.